Carroll bringing it forward. Thompson's making the run. Carroll hangs on to it though. Still David Carroll. Could go all the way here. Oh, what a goal!
Hello, I'm Phil Catchpole and welcome to this week's Ringing the Blues. On this week's show, we have all the action and reaction from both the Barnsley and Coventry City matches. We catch up with Mark Bowring, who runs Mission Dispatch and is now sending Wycombe Wanderers paraphernalia all over the world via the Wycombe Wanderers website. We also catch up with Rich Barter, a chairboy in New Zealand, and he tells us what it's like on a match day for him. But first, let's head to Mexico City for the results with Uri.
We are ringing the blues from Mexico City. My name is Uri, and these are the results for the Championship League. Cardiff City 0, Swansea City 2, Birmingham City 0, Watford 1, Blackburn Rovers 1, Norwich City 2, Bournemouth 5, Huddersfield Town 0, Derby County 0, Stoke City 0, Luton Town 3, Preston North End 0, Middlesbrough 3, Millwall 0, Nottingham Forest 1, Brentford 3, Queen's Park Rangers 0, Reading 1, Rotherham United 2, Bristol City 0, Sheffield Wednesday 1, Barnsley 2, Wycombe Wanderers 1, Coventry City 2. Come on, chairboys, what's happening? Okay, so for Chairboy Spanish this week, most football clubs have a bogey team, meaning a team that either always beats them or against which they habitually enjoy bad luck. Today was the 10th game in a row that Coventry have beaten Wycombe. So Coventry are Wycombe's bogey team. So bogey, how do we call the bogeyman in Mexico? We call it El Coco. So, child, if you behave bad, the Coco will come after you. So, bogey team, El Coco. Coventry son El Coco de Wycombe. Okay, there's something I like about Coventry, and that's the music that comes from that little town. Do you remember the specials? Ghost Town? The ghosts are scary, so is the bogeyman. Okay, such a coincidence. Back to London with my amigo Phil Catchpole at the Wycombe Wanderers Chairboys Ringing the Blues Studios. Until next week, adios!
A Wednesday night trip to Barnsley. Wycombe took on the Tykes at Oakwell. Here's what happened.
It was all against Bournemouth, you wouldn't have seen coming, you know. But then you wouldn't have seen Preston beating Bournemouth 3-2 last week. So it's a very open league. I think people have been saying that, and your Norwiches and your Watfords probably looking like they're running away with it, and Bournemouth perhaps in that group. But after that, I think it's hugely competitive. We've been fantastic in some games and not got what we've deserved. I'm sure things will turn around, and super confident we're going to stay in the Championship.
Well, McCarthy lets it bounce, and Styles has it, edge of the penalty area. Goes on the outside and scores! Low, driven across the face of goal. Allsop really unsighted, I think, perhaps by the defender. And Wycombe have succumbed to a goal on the break here from Callum Styles. And it's Barnsley 1, Wycombe 0. McCleary is bundled down in the box and the referee blows his whistle and it's a penalty. Gareth McCleary wins a penalty. His control was excellent. Apo Helm, who has looked clumsy when the ball's on the deck, manhandled McCleary to the floor. Joe Jacobson then up against Walton and scores. And Wycombe are level here at Oakwell. Goal coming on 48 minutes from the left foot of Joe Jacobson. It's Barnsley 1, Wycombe 1. Oh, that's a lovely great touch ball from Chaplin. Lovely ball on the volley. It's released. Luke Thomas, left-hand channel. Still going, still going. Is he fouled, referee? gives his second penalty. He's already blown his whistle and gives his second penalty. The ball's in the back of the net, but the referee had already blown his whistle. And it's a penalty to Barnsley. And Woodrow has scored 6 goals this season. Will it be 7? Here he comes, right-footed. And it's to the right of Ryan Allsop and in. And Barnsley lead here, 2-1. Gareth, another tight defeat in the Championship. There's not much in these games.
No, but, you know, we weren't at the races as much as we have been lately. I'll say for the last 8 games, we've been hugely competitive. I wanted to stay the same formation, the same personnel, and maybe step too far sometimes with these fixture lists. You know, we haven't got the deepest squad in the world with a couple of injuries, but still, I think we'll all admit, you know, that we're just not at the races tonight. And Barnsley, they weren't great, but they played the better stuff than us, and a few passes together. You know, we left a 2-on-2 for the penalty at the end. If you're not going to be brilliant, then keep it tight and keep it solid, and we'll take a point away from home. But, you know, it was a bad one to concede the penalty. But, you know, some real positives in there. You know, we're gelling as a team. Gareth McCleary causing havoc at the top there, you know, and yeah, I'm looking forward to Coventry on Saturday now. It's all we can do. I'm not going to dwell on this too much. Positive to the end, and let's start getting some points on the board.
Tiredness is a key, but Coventry have had their feet up tonight. So that's an extra day's rest as well. Is that going to play a part?
Well, we'll see. We'll see what team I pick, see what team they pick. But it's, you know, it's a long way home. But I think being together is good. You know, we'll be picking the bones out of that and seeing how we can be better. So maybe that's an advantage, and we can come into Saturday's game knowing that we need to up a performance. And we certainly all Coventry won. It's been a long time since we beat them, and looking forward to trying to get one over on Mark Robbins, who's a great guy and a great manager.
We've talked about the impact of Adebayo Akinfenwa this season, but he looked very tired at times this evening.
No, the big man's been absolutely phenomenal for me. As I keep saying, we wouldn't be in this Championship without him, as well as a few others. You know, he'll be wanting to get the better of the Barnsley defenders back at home. I'm sure they managed him quite well tonight, but he still managed to cause havoc in the box on a couple of set plays, and we just didn't get that final pass together. We didn't get Scotty in the way we wanted to, and do you know what? I'll take that one on the chin. Boys, rest up, because I'll need you Saturday. We'll go again.
In terms of the injured players, any news on when they'll be back?
Yeah, we got Tafazoli, Ikpeazu and Thompson all very, very close. So I'm hoping we can get them involved in this Christmas period. We're going to need some fresh legs, I'm sure. It is chaotic around this time of year. We had it last year. Nothing new to Leagues 1 and Leagues 2 teams, and we've been there. So we're really, really looking forward to having a week off at least, you know, around the Christmas week. But at the moment, all I can concentrate on is Coventry, Bournemouth, QPR. It's 3 big games. I want to get 9 points from them.
Coventry is a massive game because they came up with Wycombe last season, and they're pulling away a little bit, but it's an important game for Wycombe to get 3 points just to keep in touch going into Christmas.
Yeah, do you know, we will get enough points to survive in this league, and that's all that matters at the end of the season. You know, being in touch at Christmas is neither here nor there for me. We were top of the league at Christmas last season, and you know, obviously we had to go through the playoffs, so don't worry about where we are at Christmas, worry about where we are in May. And we're looking forward to getting the right amount of points to keep us in this division.
A narrow win for Barnsley. Here's what the home fans had to say. Tactical masterstroke.
That were a deserved win, but I honestly think they might be the worst opposition I've ever seen in Championship. They're going down.
Young Nudger.
I were a fan of Wycombe, but not after that. They played no football, just long ball tactics and complaining in the face of the ref. Horrible.
Backer.
Wycombe are cynical, defensive hoofers, with Jacobson leading the rest of his teammates in the dark arts. They'll definitely go down. They COVIDed their way into the League One playoffs, voting to stop the season, claiming they couldn't afford to test their players. There's not a lot of money there, but there are slender budgets, and then there's Wycombe. I mean, starting Akinfenwa in this division, it's ugly as hell. they probably have the worst individuals I've ever seen in second tier. But you gotta do what you gotta do in order to stay in games.
Tykes fan.
I honestly couldn't watch them every week. Shocking football.
Scott Cameron.
Horrendous game to watch. Thank God we don't have to play them again anytime soon.
Exiled.
Wycombe are by far the worst team in this league. And yet, we laboured to a narrow win. That certainly doesn't bode well. But it's 3 points, I suppose. So it could have been worse.
Ethelred.
We needed our centre-halves to concentrate for the full 90 minutes, because the ball was punted up in the air time and again. That's all Wycombe have got.
Shepley Red.
Well done, Reds. Wycombe know their limitations and are never going to play an open attacking game of football at this level. They made it difficult for us, but it was a deserved 3 points in the end.
Dodgy defence.
Fair play to them for being hard to beat. It's not good to watch, but they are good at spoiling games and will no doubt nick draws off a fair few teams.
Commercially, Wycombe Wanderers are making great strides off the pitch. Since COVID, the website has improved dramatically and you can now buy shirts and merchandise, which is now delivered by Mission Dispatch, a Wycombe Wanderers fan-run company. Mark Bowring got in contact with the club to offer his services and business appears to be good. I gave him a ring to find out how things are going.
I got in contact with the club just around the time of lockdown and said, you know, guys, look, I think, you know, you're going to have a bit of a situation here because with no fan football, you've got a store that's full of stock, no means of selling it, obviously, because they didn't have their own online store. And it was one of those where I said, you know, I can help you, but I think, you know, we need to act quickly. And so so that's exactly what the club did. You know, Neil and Pete and the whole crew there kind of rallied together to get all of the stock that was in the shop at the time into us. They've got a website built very, very quickly, which I have to say is very good. And yeah, the rest is history. You know, the stock came in, and you know, orders started flowing through. And then, as luck would have it, we got launched from eighth to third at the behest of very upset other football clubs. And as you can imagine, from there on in, the online sales have kind of gone berserk ever since.
I was about to say, I mean, the best marketing plan for a football club is to have success. So around that playoff final, you must have been doing some real business.
Yeah, and it was a real scramble, obviously, because of the whole COVID situation. You know, the supply chain everywhere has been completely decimated. So, you know, just getting hands on stock and everything else was a real challenge for the club. And, you know, I mean, we were working, you know, between us, you know, all hours of the day and night just to make sure that we could facilitate, you know, those orders. And as I say, you know, a lot of the stuff went on pre-order. And I think, you know, with Wycombe Wanderers, you know, they've been League Two, League One. And of course, nobody really knew, you know, how many shirts, you know, they would sell, you know, the playoff shirts, etc. So the plan was to put everything on pre-order so that they could effectively order exactly the right amount of stock and then obviously some surplus. So as opposed to it being, you know, orders coming in, you know, sort of fluidly, you know, throughout the day, which happens with, you know, a lot of our clients, you know, you'll come in, you'll have 100 orders or 50 orders, whatever. It was pre-order goes on sale and then it closes and then we'll get shipped in. I mean, thousands of, you know, we had the championship playoff books, the shirts, etc. And so it was a real kind of, you know, avalanche, if you like, of stock coming in. And just turning it round and getting it out the door as quickly as possible.
And the question is, really, what are the top sellers in terms of Wycombe Wanderers stuff?
Well, funny enough, this is a question I've asked a few people and it surprised everyone. So the hottest selling product on the online store before the playoff campaign happened. Believe it or not, was actually the silver Wycombe Wanderers beer mugs.
That doesn't surprise me.
Yeah, no, it's quite a thing. And then of course the playoff shirts were very, very popular, as were the souvenir books. I think they did a set run on those. I can't remember how many it was, but it was into the thousands, and every single one of those sold. The playoff merchandise was, you know, phenomenal. And then of course the kit launch came along, and absolutely bonkers. And it was quite a funny thing, because obviously we do the printing of the shirts in house, and I remember talking to Ben in the back office, and we were talking about how many decals to order for the shirts, you know, so the badges and the player names and numbers and everything else. And so I've ordered a couple of packs of the Championships League badges. I'm not quite sure how many we'll need. And I saw, how many did you get through last season? He said, I think we only printed badges on three shirts in the shop the whole of last season. So I think now we're probably up at about 1,500 or so shirts that have had the badges on. So, you know, everything's kind of been almost the unknown, if you like. So it's been quite reactive. And as I say, you know, the supply chain has made things very challenging. But you know, the fans have been brilliant. You know, I mean, I've you know, because I'm a fan, you know, yes, we're a partner with a club and a supplier, but you know, ultimately I'm an avid Wycombe Wanderers supporter. And so, you know, I've been taken to social media when people have been asking questions about, you know, I've been waiting for my shirt for 2 weeks, or does anybody know when these are being sent out? And I've kind of made a rub for my own back, because, you know, I'm sitting there watching telly at 11 o'clock at night, getting WhatsApp messages and messengers from people. But, you know, just happy to help.
As a massive Wycombe Wanderers fan, which I know you are, and the family as well, it must be great to kind of step in and help out the club, especially in this really challenging time.
It has been, Phil, you know, and it's, you know, I think, it, you know, in any walk of life, whether it's football, whether it's business, and obviously football is a business nowadays, you know, everybody wants to hear about success stories. Now, you know, obviously it's not my place to talk about figures, but what I do know is that within the first 4 months of the online store going live, it massively outnumbered the entire turnover that the club took within the shop the previous season, for the whole of the season. And, you know, it has been, and funny enough, I was at the club today for the business networking meeting, and Neil Peters was doing a presentation, and he said himself, you know, that the money that it's generated to the club, you know, has been an absolute godsend. And, you know, to be a part of that is great, you know, and it's, you know, to me, it shows that the club has moved on to another level. You know, they're thinking outside the box. You know, they were in a situation where, you know, where all clubs were, where, you know, it was like, you know, we've got no ticket revenue, you know, we've got no bar revenue, we've got no food revenue, and now we can't even sell our own merchandise. And you know, to get an online store, you know, up and running as quickly as they did and we did together was quite a thing, because, you know, normally these things take quite a lot of time and back and forth and all the rest of it. But this was really one of those, you know, let's just get the job done. And it has been an absolute success, and it's great to be a part of it.
It's not just the UK and South Bucks you're sending stuff to either. I mean, you can dispatch anywhere in the world, is that right?
Absolutely anywhere. Yeah, and it's quite funny, actually. We've got this really great little sort of widget tool on our dashboard, and it's like a heat map of where we're shipping to in the world. So you can view by, you know, by individual clients, and it's like the heat map changes depending on how many orders are going to those places. And I'm a bit nerdy with stuff like that, so I sort of sit there and analyse it. But I mean, we've had orders from everywhere. Mexico. I'm not sure if it's your friend Yuri. Chile, America, Canada. Quite a decent following, actually, in Scandinavia, in Norway, Sweden, and another. So yeah, I mean, absolutely everyone. It's quite interesting, really, when you sort of see firsthand what kind of following that the club does have from, you know, not just Buckinghamshire and not just the UK, but literally all over the world.
Well, it's part of the Coohig mantra, isn't it? The worldwide Wycombe Wanderers phenomenon. So people listening into this and they're thinking, right, I need to get something nice for Christmas for X, Y and Z. What are the cut-off dates for getting the orders in if they're to be delivered on time for Christmas?
About a week ago. No, I'm just kidding. So the official dates are sent to us by the various carriers, so DHL and Royal Mail, etc. Last postal dates really are the sort of tail end of next week. But I think that the caveat is that all of the networks at the moment are at capacity. I mean, it's a busy time of year anyway. We're just off the tail end of Black Friday. And then obviously with the whole COVID situation, the networks got swamped at the beginning of COVID. I mean, to give you an idea, our churn of work going out of the warehouse in March was almost double what it was last year on certain products. And that's been echoed, throughout, a lot of the online retail sector. Online has gone absolutely bonkers over the last few months, and the carriers are kind of struggling to keep up. And obviously that combined with peak season means that, there are delays. So what I would say to people is that, if you are trying to get stuff for Christmas, try and order it now. And obviously, the shirts, that they need to be printed. So, there's a couple of days lead time on those. And actually, if you want to order an Akin Fenwell shirt, they're getting double quick because the number of shirts that man sells, I cannot begin to tell you. And it's quite funny because when you print the shirts, because his name's so big, it takes longer than everybody else's shirts because you can't print it in one go.
Oh, so in the interest of logistics and that, so we need Dominic Gape to score a hat-trick against Coventry, a huge spike in Gape shirts, because there's only four letters, and that will help you out, week.
And we need to sign Denver Bar. That's what we need to do.
Right, if you're listening to this, Gareth, then in January, when you're signing players, short names and people who score lots of goals with short names, please, OK?
Absolutely.
Well, Mark, good luck for this busy time of year and great to hear a fan getting involved with the club and making the experience for fans better as well, and also getting the word of Wycombe Wanderers out all around the world. It's fantastic to hear about.
Thank you to everybody that's ordered and supported the football club, because that's what it's all about. It's about generating money for Wycombe Wanderers Football Club, and we'd delight to be a part of that.
So could Wycombe end their hoodoo against Coventry City? It was at Adams Park in front of 2,000 fans. Here's what happened.
We will get enough points to survive in this league, and that's all that matters at the end of the season. Being in touch at Christmas is neither here nor there for me. We were top of the league at Christmas last season, and obviously we had to go through the playoffs, so don't worry about where we are at Christmas, worry about where we are in May.
And Patterson loses it in midfield. It's Kelly again, goes for goal, and this time he doesn't make a mistake and drills it into the bottom corner past the helpless Ryan Allsop. Wonderful strike. It's Wycombe 0, Coventry 1.
Hamer, the substitute, then will take the free kick, right footed from the right wing. Whistle goes, and then it chips to the back post, and it goes right across the face of goal, and Kelly's got his second, and Coventry do have a 2-0 lead just before half time, and it's Wycombe 0, Coventry 2.
Gape finds Jacobson in space on the left. Jacobson sends it in left-footed. Akin Fenwell controls it. Wheeler pushed on the edge of the penalty area, and it's a Wycombe Wanderers. Is that a penalty or free kick? I think it's a penalty. 12 yards out, up against Ben Wilson. Jacobson left-footed, straight down the middle. It's Wycombe 1, Coventry 2.
Gareth, a game against Coventry, and it's a defeat, but Coventry always beat Wycombe, it seems.
Yeah, did they deserve it today? I don't think so. Couple of individual errors for us, but I thought we were by far the better team today. The chances count must be massive in Wycombe's favour, and we've scored right at the death, and the referees give offside when for all the world it looks onside. It's one of those days. I'm really pleased with the performance, disappointed with the result. I know results determine where we are in the league, but all I can say is we keep playing like that and we will be fine, because again, we've been more than competitive today. Really pleased with them.
A game of substitutions, really. Mark Robbins made a change on half an hour that affected the end of the first half, and then you made your own triple subs on 58 minutes, and that had an instant impact as well.
Yeah, but I don't like doing that, because the players who were on the pitch at the start are well capable of winning this game, and it's two individual mistakes that cost their places in the team. It cost me to make three changes. Daryl Hogg and Matt Bloomfield and I can't remember the other one now, but Alex Samuel, you know, they're well capable. So it's not like you're not good enough. It's we have to do this to change the impetus of the game, you know, and so I feel sorry for those guys because they're well capable of winning, and we showed that. I thought I honestly think we were a better team today. Maybe I've got it wrong, but I usually get things pretty good with my eyes, and we've got to put our chances in. We've got to stop conceding, and the first goal's a gift. The second goal, we've got to defend a set play better on half time, and we've not got to give the free kick away in the first place, you know. But you know, all these things, we're in the Championship, we're finding our feet still. We're still within a shout. I think there's going to be five or six teams scrapping for three places. We just got to finish above three of them.
Was it a big blow today because Coventry came up with Wycombe last season?
No, not at all. No. When Coventry spend money on a player like Hamer in the region of millions of pounds, then I'm absolutely fine with that. I've spent maybe my biggest ever transfer fee on Daryl Horgan, which is, I mean, a League Two fee. You know, so no, absolutely not. They're a big side. It's Coventry City, for crying out loud. So we're well pleased with where we are. We're in the Championship, competing week in, week out, and I'll put my name to that performance.
It's frustrating, is it, the mistakes that are costing Wycombe again after you sort of eradicated them after that first few games?
Yeah, do you know, it's just mistakes, individual mistakes, that's all it is. It's not like teams are carving us apart, and that's really important for me to take the positives out of that, because this is a footballing side under Mark Robbins and Eddie Vivash who play great football, and in years gone by, they've carved us apart. Absolutely none of the sort today. I thought we were by far the better team, and we just didn't score the goals. And you know, I've got to look through the results sometimes, I always do. We'll be back. We've got an easy one on Tuesday. We're second in the league away at Bournemouth. So can't wait for that now.
Coventry were hanging on at the end though. You must take great heart from that.
Yeah, of course. I take great heart from the whole performance today. From minute one to minute 90, I can probably just have a disappointing minute on 49 minutes was it. And you know, whenever Kelly scored his first goal as well. They're the two moments where I'm disappointed. But if a manager can be pleased with 88 minutes out of 90, then it's a pretty good ratio. And the fans were superb. And at the end, I'm going around clapping the fans and not one negative, you know, fan in there. It was brilliant. I think they see as well what we did today, and I'm really pleased and proud of them.
There was that little snippet before the flag went up where the fans erupted, and it felt like one of those famous Wycombe comebacks, but and it taken been. Away from them.
It should have been, you know. Scotty Cash gets onside, how the linesman's give it, and taking so much time giving it, it's just gone against us. I thought the officials were going to get better at this level, and I'm not going to say any more than that. we've been on the end of a couple of decisions that have gone against us. There was one where we're in possession and it's hit the referee and the referee gave it back to Coventry. Again, baffled by it, but I wouldn't like to be a ref. I've said this many times. It's tough, and you know, I just hope that we can get some decisions going our way second half of the season, because it certainly hasn't gone our way this side of it.
And looking ahead to Tuesday, I saw Uchik Piazza and Ryan Tafazoli out on the grass earlier on doing some intensive running and stuff. Are they getting closer?
Very much so, yeah. I think Uchi will be days away, and Tafazoli probably Boxing Day is a target for him. We need him, definitely, but like I say, on today's performance, every one of those players can come off the pitch with their heads held high, frustrated, deserved the point, didn't get it. Some things are just out of our control, but that performance was well in our control. I'm really proud of it.
So yet another victory for Coventry against Wycombe Wanderers, and we've got the thoughts of the Sky Blue fans coming up later on in the show for the Opposition View, part two. 2,000 fans back in at Adams Park, and it was great to hear them getting behind the lads on Saturday, despite the result. But what if watching iFollow for every game is the only option you have? Wycombe fan Rich Barter lives on the other side of the world. Here's what his match day looks and sounds like.
Hi, my name is Rich Barter. And for the last 12 years, I've lived in Rotorua in the central North Island of New Zealand. To picture it, Rotorua has a population that's roughly half the size of High Wycombe and is a region that's made up of huge areas of forest and lakes, but is most famous for its geothermal activity and bubbling mud pools, geysers, and a strong Maori connection. It's hard to imagine anywhere too different from High Wycombe, but there is a small contingent of Wycombe fans forming here, friends of mine who found themselves swept along on this incredible journey of ours. Like a lot of people my age, I became a Wycombe fan back in the early 90s. I didn't grow up in a footballing family. My dad didn't support a team, so I had no influences in that regard. I certainly never played the game at that stage. But in 1991 and again in 1993, some pals of mine from down the street took me along to Wembley for the two FA Cup final wins. I remember it was the 93 final against Runcorn. I was 15. That made me suddenly fall in love with everything about the experience of football and with Wycombe Wanderers. A couple of months later, I had a season ticket for our upcoming league debut campaign, and Saturday afternoons and Tuesday evenings, under the lights, my whole life revolved around watching Wycombe. Looking back, I'm kind of sad I missed those heady conference years, but I got there in the end. I remember being behind the goal in the Valley End for the League Cup second leg match against today's opponents, Coventry, then in the Premiership, of course, and seeing us roar to that four-goal lead. And behind the same goal when Jason Cousins got the ball lodged in the stanchion against Scunthorpe. Special memories. Being a Wycombe fan on the other side of the world is, of course, means setting the alarm early for games, very early. Depending on the time of year, that can mean a 2 a.m, 3 a.m, or like today, a 4 a.m. kickoff. To avoid waking the whole house, I slip out of bed, grab the laptop, stick the coffee machine on, and find a quiet corner in the living room where I plug my headphones in. It's not exactly beers with your mates and the smell of the burger van, but the buzz of excitement is always there. The adrenaline of getting up and the anticipation. Will today be 3 points? Being summer in the Southern Hemisphere, we're only a week or so away from the longest day, but at 4 a.m, it's still pitch black. So this will be how I spend the entire match, sat in darkness, my face lit up by my laptop, trying desperately not to yell out too loud at key moments. As I'm watching though, I'm not alone. I'll always have my phone in my hand, flicking through Twitter to feel connected to the fans and the club.
Fans now in a subdued silence to 2000, and there goes the whistle literally a second after the ball was kicked back into the Wycombe after restart. And Wycombe now with a mountain to climb in the second half. Half time here at Adams Park, Wycombe Wanderers 0, Coventry City 2.
Well, 2-0 down at half time, and not a scoreline I would have expected after that first half an hour. I really have lost a lot of sleep this season for not a lot of goals. 2-0 makes it hard, but maybe if we can make a tactical change as effectively as Coventry did and give ourselves a chance in the box, we can see something magical in this second half that sees us turn this around. And that will make my Sunday feel a whole lot better.
2,000 fans are back in to see it. Full-time, Wycombe Wanderers 1, Coventry City 2.
It's 6 a.m. here in New Zealand, and morning has broken and the light is pouring into the house. I honestly had no doubt we were going to get something. I've just re-watched the Kashgar equaliser that was ruled out, and he looks on, so it's an absolute gutter. My kids are still fast asleep, so I'm going to sneak back to bed, though I suspect I won't be able to sleep now.
So another 3 points for Coventry against Wycombe Wanderers. Here's what the Sky Blues fans thought of the game. London CCFC.
Wycombe, the gift that keeps on giving.
Paxman 11.
That was a deserved win. I'm just disappointed we didn't score one or two more from some great opportunities, which would have really put it to bed. Penalty for them? I'm not sure it was. Wycombe need to be beating teams like us at home, and we've come away with all 3 points.
Sky Blue Dreamer.
We made such hard work of that. Slow start, and arguably a bit fortunate to go two up, and then a soft penalty lets them back in, and we start dropping off. Akin Fenwa comes on, and we don't defend against him as successfully as we've done in the past. I'm grateful for the 3 points, but we didn't deserve them, and we couldn't have complained if they'd scored a legit equaliser.
Liquid Gold.
Their late goal looked fine to me. I think we got away with it.
At Susie Blue Sky.
Yes, we got a lucky break at the end, but it was probably balanced out by the debatable penalty.
AFC Coventry.
Ooh, that was nail-biting to watch in the second half. And I don't think their goal was offside. Some of our players were average at best today, although Hamer was immense when he came on. But we get 3 points, and that's not to be sniffed at.
Larry David.
They went all gung-ho with 30 minutes to go. It was end-to-end stuff, and a better attacking team than us would have put 4 past them today. We're just not clinical enough.
Evo 1883.
Wycombe fans can moan all they like about the offside. They should moan more about their horrendous 1930s style of play and their attempts to shithouse a result every week. Yes, we were lucky at the end, but sod it. It evens itself out over the season.
James Imus.
Were Wycombe, of all teams, seriously complaining about time wasting?
Cov Kid, 55.
To be fair, Wycombe have the lowest budget in the division and are a very small club playing in a tough league. I don't think you can blame them for playing to their strengths.
Right, that's your lot for this week. Many thanks to Mark Bowring and Rich Barter. Full match commentary of Wycombe's trip to Bournemouth will be live on BBC Three Counties on the 98 FM frequency. In the meantime, keep the faith and come on, you Blues.